for Trinidad and Tobago. We have it down to a knot, red, black and white in we hearts. We know that we have the fire when it comes on to the wire. Our passion, it makes us strong, cause this is our fighting song. Whoa, bring it home.
Good to be back.
Good to be back, man.
How was Rio?
Competition or Rio?
Both.
Well, as you can see, it was a successful trip for me with the competition. It wasn't the title defense that everybody hoped it was. It would be, but I still came out with a medal, so I'm thankful for that.
I threw further in the final than I did in London, right?
Well, that doesn't matter. If I threw less and I won, I didn't even care. Once I win, it doesn't matter. Like, the distance doesn't matter to... Unless you're going to try and break the record or something, that is always a goal. But the winning distance is like, it doesn't matter. Once you win, you win.
Yeah. Were you feeling additional pressure when your meet came on, knowing that we hadn't medal at that point?
No, not really, because I I think if we had medal, it might have been more pressure. Because then I know I have to get a medal. Because other people are already getting medals and I can't walk away without a medal. So it wasn't more pressure for me knowing that the team didn't medal. That was unfortunate, but.
All right. What'd it feel like to get on the podium again? How does it compare to London?
I think this one was actually, I was more, in tune with what I was doing in this Olympics and the outcome. Instead of in London where I was just surprised by everything. So knowing that I worked my way hard onto the podium this time, it was something of a relief knowing that I am the only athlete from 2012 back on the podium in the 2016 Olympics. So that was something great knowing that out of the top three from last time, I am back here with an additional two persons. So that was being a double medalist in the Olympics, that is something great.
Why do javelin champions change that often? Is it plenty wear to anybody or
something? Because it's always somebody coming. It's always somebody coming for the title. It's and every year, if you check the stats, everybody throws far. And not every year you're gonna have your best year, but I wanted, like I always said, I wanted to win the Rio Olympics, but as you can see, it wasn't for me. But the guy who won, he has been in terrific shape this year. He has been throwing 91 meters. He threw 90 meters three times this year, so he has been in terrific shape. I knew he was always going to be the main contender in the Olympics. So before him, it was like only two guys have ever won the Olympics back-to-back in the history. That was, history is what, since 1908? So that is not something easy to be done. So I knew it was going to be a challenge, but I went in with my hopes high. But as you can see, I had to settle for third.
Happy for third. How do you feel about your own performance in the first round and the final?
In the qualification, it was a good throw. I was relaxed. I wasn't that relaxed because I was a bit more scared than in the final, because the qualification is always hard for me. It's the hardest part for me. Once I get through the qualification, I'm relaxed in the final. So yeah, being able to get that one big throw on my first in the qualification, I was happy. I was like, yeah. Let's get it done and go back and get some rest. Going into the final, I knew I needed to go big to win. From the beginning of the year, I told my coach, whoever is going to win Olympics is going to throw 90 meters. So I was like, I needed to go big. I think maybe that was my downfall in a little bit. My first three throws was good. I had a little consistency with the distance. I was around 85, 83 meters. But after, I think my legs had a little bit, wear and tear. Because if I had one more day to recover, I think I'll have done better. Because I know how I was training before, and one more day I think I might be able to throw 90 meters because I was in pretty good shape and I was feeling it. Brazil wasn't like as organized as London, and things were a little bit further, and it was my second Olympics, so I'm still getting some experience about different countries, and you know, every country is not going to be the same. But Brazil was a little bit different. Like, I remember the first day we went to training in Brazil, and we got back to the village, and they only had two scanners working outside, and the lines was like, for example, I sure it had lines for football on Friday. Yeah. That lines like that, you had to wait to get inside, and that was horrible because you have to understand the mass amount of athletes you have coming through here, and that is not something good. One of the better things for the athletes village, the Olympic village, is that you can get inspiration from athletes, because just seeing someone in person, you might never think you might see in your life. You will see them walking normal in the village. Like, you will see Serena Williams and these different athletes walking normal. Like, I remember I saw Djokovic, the tennis player. And I was like, hey, I need to get a picture. And like, when you turn around, he's gone. So it's like this. It's normal. Everybody is just chill.
Who was the person that most athletes wanted a shot with? Serena, Bolt.
Yeah, I think, not too much. I think a lot of people have pictures with Bolt. He's always around. But I think, with Neymar, I think, maybe that was the most popular. But that's the thing. I think he came into the village like one time, and that was it. He couldn't stay in the village because that would be crazy. But I think Serena, a lot of people were going crazy off of the gymnastic girls. The American girls, Gabby and Simone, a lot of people were complaining about the rooming, and we had, like, for me, only we faced a few problems, minor problems, like nothing I would distract me from doing anything. Like, we sometimes the hot water didn't work, and the AC maybe didn't work, or the room wasn't clean. That was it. I didn't see any. On my part, I couldn't even talk for myself. I didn't see any major problems that could hamper any performance. I always say, all sport, big sporting events, you're going to have a lot of criticism. As an athlete, you're going to have a lot of criticism. Once you want to be great, you're going to have a lot of criticism. So you have to learn to deal with it, no matter what. So at this stage, you can't afford for that to make you falter. I saw, because I'm always on my phone. Like, I'm always on Instagram and just scrolling. But you see it, but that's the thing. If you focus on it, it's going to be something different. Like, I had my roommate, a young one, Jerim, and me and him was talking, because every time he sees something, he's focusing on that. And he's like, I need to comment. No, you don't need to comment. It's like, you see it, move on. Because it's going to happen over and over. You're going to see something every day. For me, it's not like that. I see it, I move on. Because at the end of the day, I always say, you do great, you're going to have critics. You could have done better. If, for example, I won in 2012, he didn't throw far. What do you want? this is the same. So it's like this. I always say, once you're doing something in the public's eye, you're going to have critics. So I can't say if it affected them, but it didn't affect me in any way. I get it all the time. Even maybe today. The way people say things, they may not mean it as straight criticism.
Like what?
But I saw an article after I finished throwing in Brazil, and it was like, Keyshawn fails to repeat. It's like, you know how strong fail is of a word? That is a very strong word for an athlete. Like, if an athlete sees that and you say, hey, like, the whole country think I fail. You can't stop that. Whatever the public want to say, they say. So,
Make it sound so simple.
Yeah.
Like, why don't you throw 92?
Yeah, it's like, why you don't?
Why did I think of that? You know?
Well, I would be like, what do you think I tried to do? Throw 10? It's not like I'm trying to throw 10 meters. I'm trying to throw the furthest I can throw. But at the end of the day, once everything don't come together, it's not going to happen. My throw in the qualification, that was a pretty good throw. Like, I always say, you can't go searching for a big throw. And in the qualification, I wasn't searching for a big throw. I was searching for a throw just to make it into the final. And as you can see, I got a better throw because I was relaxed. I got into, I have a picture on my phone. It's the best position I have gotten in for the entire year. And I got that position like twice in training before, just maybe 2 days before the competition. And that's when I knew I was capable of doing something good, because I knew once I hit that position, I'm going to throw good. And then I got that position in the qualification. I was like, as you can see, from the time I released the javelin, I knew it was good. I put my hands up. I knew that this was going to be a good throw.
What do we need to do to be better, to put our athletes in a better position to succeed?
We need structure, and we don't have structure. We don't have a system. We all countries who produce mass amount of athletes have a system. China don't have a system. We expect things to be achieved, but we don't have a system to achieve these things. We expect an athlete to, okay, we're going to get a medal in 4 years. How? You don't know what I did today. You don't know what I did yesterday. How you know if I'm going to achieve something tomorrow? So Jamaica has system. Big countries have, Cuba has system. America has system. Everybody have a system. But we don't have a system, but we want results.
Your sport being the last sport for training. Everybody is posing with pictures next to the big statue of Jesus and so on. Is that in your mind as well? Everybody's out there having fun, is it? You have to hold the tension in longer than anybody else.
I can thank the sport for that, because since I was a junior, it's always been that way. So I've grown accustomed to it. World Juniors, character, the previous Olympics, the World Championship, javelin, always last. So I've grown accustomed to it.
You get less sightseeing.
Yeah, in Olympics, I didn't get nothing. We left the day after. In Brazil, I got to go to the Christ, the Redeemer, and I got to see like the beach and different things. So that was better for me, but it's always a lot more tense, because like I would like to go to the track and support the rest of my team each and every time they compete, but I can't, because I need to rest. I need to rest my legs. I need to rest after I train. I train every day leading up, and while they competed, I'm training. So it's different. I think that is one of the only thing I don't like too much about the Olympics, because I don't get to see or do as much as other athletes, because once you compete early and you finish, you can get to do a lot more, but then I have to wait for the last day. So I guess I have no choice. Everybody who helped me, including B-Mobile, TTOC, and the Ministry of Sport, and my family, my friends, everybody who helped me to get there, I was thankful for that. Just knowing that I'm in this Olympics that I have planned so long for, since the beginning of my career. So I'm thankful for everybody who supported me and keep supporting me.
Get ready now, come on, let's go. For Trinidad and Tobago, we have it down to one knot. Red, black and white in we hearts. We know that we have.